Finally, I asked whether there is such a thing as a no-say state, because we could keep people going with respirators, medicines for many, many days. The definition, as I understand it, of no-say some years ago was 3 days. I mean,
you're right, right. Yeah.
The second thing is, if we say shash rehistomen, doesn't that still make it a scrape of the right?
Exactly. It's still awesome. It's still awesome. It's still awesome.
That's another. Third, Ralph, the former chief Sephardic rabbi of Tel Aviv, Rabbi
David Halevi?
Correct. Yeah. He has a whole position where you're allowed to remove
I know.
You want
me to discuss that now? I can discuss what?
Because you're also Maharich Misosa. So I'd like your response to those, please.
Okay. That's all? No. Okay. Let me start with the last one, because the first two are much more complicated. The question of whether or not the person can pull the plug or not, believe it or not, is not just a question of life and death, which is the way we were posing up until now, but to be intellectually honest, this goes back to a major historical controversy on a statement of the Ramah. I'm going to be intellectually honest today, and we're going to be intellectually honest. Let me tell you what we're going to do. If we prowse to the Shulchan Aruch and Simin Shin Lama Tesson Yeridayah, okay? I wasn't planning to do this, but since he asked the question, I'm going to do it. The Ramah over there discusses the question of the do's and don'ts with a person who's deathly ill, who's in the last throes of their life and death over here. There's no question this person is as a ghost as can be. What can you do with this person towards the end of their life? So the Shulchan Aruch says, and the Ramah says, we can't start the Tahara prematurely, because if the person wasn't depressed up until now, they're surely going to depress them. You're going to be moving the body inappropriately, and therefore that might cause a kir of Misa. You can't say, maybe you want to hear a preheat of your eulogy to the person, because that will depress them. You can't tell them to pick his tachrichim or pick his oven. So that can't be done, even if you're psychologically causing to die earlier. However, the Ramah says, doing something physical to cause them to die earlier, which is called gramas amisa, is prohibited. But then he brings a new concept. Hasaras hamaneya muteras. Taking away impediments to death is halachically permissible. That's the Ramah. The question now arises, what does that mean, taking away impediments to death? What does that mean? This became a major halacha kosalera in the 1700s. The two major disputants were Shelish Shuvas Beis Yaakov, Shelish Shuvas Shvus Yaakov. These are two major halachic achronim, Shelish and Shuvas. And each came out with a different opinion, which are worlds apart. Listen to this. The Ramah also mentions that he allows, as taking away impediments to death, stopping a wood chopper from chopping wood in the backdrop, because a person can't die if you have turbulence in the background. A person has to die with his peace. Therefore, you tell the wood chopper, take a lunch break. It's quiet, and the soul is able to leave the body. Or taking salt out of the mouth, which they believe is to keep a person alive, take the salt out of the mouth, and the person expires. These are removing impediments to death. Comes along the Beis Yaakov, and the Beis Yaakov says, in his shuvas, in his response to literature, from here we see a klal gadol. So when a person reaches the level of a ghost, if whatever that means, at the end of life, the mitzvah or refuah no longer applies to this person. And therefore, if that's the case, you have to have nature take its course. You can't be Mechallel Shabbos to this person anymore. And therefore, normal medical treatment, which was done to Mechallel Shabbos, at this point, it's just being marich, it's causing the person to be prolonged in this agony and pain, etc., etc. Therefore, let nature take its course and get out of there and let him die in peace. That's the Beis Yaakov's interpretation, and he therefore applies it even to regular medical care. The Shvus Yaakov disagreed. The Shvus Yaakov says, if that was what the Ramah meant, so the Ramah should have said explicitly, when a person is this type of goses, when he's that sick, definitely ill, he's at the end of life, ain't but Mr. Shore Fool Klal. He didn't say that. What he did is he gave examples of stopping a wood chopper and taking salt out of the mouth. What does that seem to indicate? That indicates you're able to basically take away supernatural things that are still maintaining that person, supernatural things. But when it comes to natural medical care, you got to continue to the person's last breath on the face of the earth. Which means you can't stop anything. Chil Shabbos has to be done, everything has to be done, all the way to the end. Now those are two radical interpretations of the Ramah. I bring it to the 20th century, very quickly. A gadol like Rav Chaim David Halevi, who you quoted before, he paskens like the Beis Yaakov. If he allows you to remove medicines, he says in his mind, pulling the plug on the respirator, is he taking away a monea in his mind, and therefore that's removal of impediments to death. That's his opinion. When he said that, and it was published in the Tehumim, For those who read the Tuchumin, there was a Chai V'Kayam. What are you talking about? That's not just taking away impediments to death. That's Gramas Hamisa. That's why a very large group of Poskim said that is Gramas Hamisa, not Hasaras Hamineya. Therefore, they were not willing to accept that. But his psak about removing medical care was accepted by many Poskim. I'll tell you who very shortly. You have on the other side of the coin, Gadol like the Tzitz Eliezer, who Paskin like the Shus Yaakov, that you got to continue everything up until the last minute. It's not benefiting the person, irrelevant, you got to continue to the end until the person stops breathing. That's the Tzitz Eliezer's opinion, which is accepted by many Charedim to this very day. How did Rav Moshe and Rav Arbach Zatzal Paskin? If you look in their tshuvis, believe it or not, they were closer in their Psak Halacha to the Beis Yaakov than to the Shus Yaakov. For anybody who wants to be intellectually honest, why am I saying this? Because Rav Moshe and Rav Arbach say, when you reach that level of sickness, and the medical therapy is no longer therapeutically benefiting you anymore, and it's just causing you pain and anguish and prolonging death, and it's not curative anymore, the mitzvah rapi rapi no longer applies. However, you still have to give food, drink, even artificially, and oxygen to the person who has a deficiency in breathing, that you have to give, and painkillers and such and such. But medical care, radioactive therapy, could dump anything, operations, if it's not going to help the person, you're not mechuyev to give it. And the patient has autonomy here to make the decision, thank you but no thank you, or if he wrote a living will, he can give somebody else, the surrogate, to make that decision. So therefore, the answer to your question is, it depends upon which camp you're thinking about. When it comes to ghosts, I'll be honest with you. We've taken the term today in this medical literature, and we've extended it back more than 3 days before death. And that's a big problem many Poskim have with the question. What we've done is we ended up basically saying that we don't have to worry about 3 days, and even if you're before 3 days, if it's obviously going to die, then we basically start this type of phenomenon to take place. Once again, it's not the Goseis that was Chazal talking about. In fact, somebody told me before, they once asked Rav Moshe Zatzal, what Goseis B'Zman Hazeh, and he says, we've lost the ability to define it. Some of the doctors have always told me before, they think they have a medical interpretation of Goseis, which I'm not going to get into now. The third question you posed was, which I didn't answer. If something's a suffix shrich is done, you can't do it. You have to be Sheval Tasa anyway. Yes?
Wait, before, because I want to leave the rest of the time for the other questions that we have left.
Yeah.
And as I said before, I didn't think that the three primary sources that you brought, both the Talmud, both the Chacham Sofer and the Chacham Tzvi, I didn't feel was adequately presented the other side. You did mention that, so I don't have time to address that, and I'm going to want to leave the questions open to the audience.
I'll tell you what.
You did say specifically, and you quoted that Benjamin Wolfish testified that Absalavajic didn't hold by brainstem death. Shama, can you hit the video that you just
let
had?
Me see.
It's a 2 minute video, if you just show it.
I met with Rabbi Salavajic in 1983-84 to discuss this concept of brainstem death, and Rabbi Salavajic told me personally that he accepted it. Based on the testimony of Rabbi Moshe Tendler, who said that this test is conclusive concerning the death of an individual. And Rabbi Soloveitchik accepted it, and as a result of his acceptance, I wrote that letter to Rabbi Silber. I'll testify to that. As far as the Gemara's definition of death, the Rav felt that it was the stopping of breathing that was the definition of death, according to the Gemara. 1983, or more possibly the beginning of 84, after I got this letter from Rabbi Silber, I went to see the Rav on the subject. I called Rabbi Tendler first. Rabbi Tendler told me about the Harvard criteria and the brainstem death and so on, and I went to see the Rav on the subject. And I explained to him what Rabbi Tendler had told me about brainstem death, and he asked me whether Rabbi Tendler is certain that this test is conclusive without any doubt, and that it is have been tested and it's accepted as conclusive proof that the brainstem is dead. I said yes, and I offered to have Rabbi Tendler call the Rav, and the Rav said, no, it's not necessary. If Rabbi Tendler says that this is so, he knows what he's talking about in these matters, and we can accept it. And that's when I wrote the letter to Rabbi Silber, explaining to him the procedure and telling him the exact language that should be written into the Pennsylvania law as a definition of death.
I can open up the floor to other questions.
Okay. One thing is interesting with that tape is is the fact that he said it was explained to him that blood flow shows you a definitive stoppage of activity to the brain But once again, that's a medical problem. The Rebbe was told that, he was given misinformation. So once again, it can play both directions.
There's another problem with the Tate.
Right.
Which one shall we believe?
That's another question. What's worse is the fact that all the Rav's major Talmidim, including Rav Herschel Schechter, as well as his Mishpacha, as Rav Aaron Lichtenstein, I've spoken to all of them, nobody says the Rav held that way. So to me, it's just a pliat summa that one person should say and everybody else disagrees.
But this is Rabbi Wolfish. The quote was from Rabbi Wolfish.
I know. So there's a steer Rabbi Wolfish. True. That's a steer Rabbi Wolfish, but it's not a steer Rabbi Salvation. Yeah. Go ahead.
I have a question that I think some of us have discussed over the last couple of days.
Let me hear.
From an ethical point of view.
Yeah.
Yesterday, in the discussions with some of the professionals from the New York Organ Donation Program, the question was asked whether, in the process of heart transplants, for example, whether the organs are removed from the donor before a match is found for the recipient. And we were told explicitly that that's not what they do, but that the organs are not removed from the donor until a match is found and everything is prepared so that the surgery for the donor patient takes place immediately prior to, for the specific purpose of, the surgery of the recipient patient.
Right.
If we take the position that brainstem death is not death, or chashash,
okay.
Then on what basis can the recipient receive somebody who is being removed from that person for the specific purpose of being given to me?
Excellent question. If you've ever noticed, I always see this enigma, that everybody from Israel sent to America for transplants. When it comes to sending all the big rebbes and the rabbanim, you go to America for transplants. Don't do it in Israel. And I always wondered why. And I found two different gedolim who gave their terutzim to this. One Rav Aaron Salavejit Zatzal, and one Yibadol Lachaim, Rabbi Bleich, and one of his Hebrew tshuvas. And they both came to the same conclusion. But once again, what you're telling me is an insight, because that's not what they were of the opinion. Both of these gedolim say the problem you're referring to is if you're a recipient of a transplant and it's being matched one-to-one, then you're violating the isul of ne'ivus of mitzvah. If you say that this is murder, you're asking somebody to be murdered to save your life. And therefore, it's a violation of alav d'raisa of lif ne'ivus of mitzvah. Now, if that's the medical metzius, that would therefore prohibit you to have the right to put your name on the list to be a recipient. There's no question. And that was the assumption in Eretz Yisrael, that since there's so few over there, it's really, they love the assumption Eretz Yisrael is personalized. But in America, they said, this is what they wrote in their articles. If you want to tell me it's not true, but this is what they wrote in their articles as the preliminary. What?
That is not true.
What?
No, Rabbi Flau, I just want to elaborate on the fact that there are a number of people in this room who are from the religious and Jewish, and some who are non-Jewish in the room.
Okay. All right. Now, thank you. What I want to therefore mention is that when Rabbi Bleich and Rabbi Salavechi both gave a permissibility to be a recipient in America, they were under the supposition, and they write this in their works, that the organs are harvested irrelevant of who the recipient is, because you have more recipients than donors, and you're put on a list. And therefore, if that's the case, putting your name on a list is not a guarantee you'll ever receive the organ, because there could be hundreds of people who are put on the list. It might be at the end that you are the genetic match or whatever, but that's not knowing you put your name on the list. If that's the case, the organ's going to be harvested whether you put your name on the list or not. Therefore, since the organ's available and you didn't cause it to be taken out, you can be a recipient of it. That's their assumption. If you're telling me that's not the way it works medically, then we got a problem.
That is not the way it works medically.
Is that the case?
Absolutely the way.
My husband is a recipient of a heart.
Right.
When the person passed away,
right,
the person was in a heart, the accident.
Right.
They harvested her heart, and they went down the list. and they saw who matched it, but they harvested the organ before they made it.
The whole medical community was here yesterday.
I'm sorry.
They said that's not the way it works.
But I'm sorry.
I know your husband received the heart, but the people who actually took out the heart were here. The surgeons were here. They said, we don't take out the heart until we have a recipient match, because the heart only has 4 hours of life outside the body.
I understand that. I can understand it. And they called and they said that we're waiting to see. There's one other person that matches it. We're going to see if the organ is coming to you. And they took him right into the operation.
That's very important.
Wasn't removed from the body.
We don't know.
The way this works is that the person, they do search through the list, and they do look for a recipient match.
Right.
But the surgery to remove the heart is not performed until the match is found.
Sometimes they don't remove the organs because they have not found the appropriate recipient, means they're murdering someone for you. If you don't put your name on the list, they will not murder that person for you, and some of these organs stay there. And the question that is asked by these people and David is, how can you allow people in your community, your congregation, to put themselves and allow themselves to get a heart or lung transplant if it's murdering other people?
It's not a question, but I work in transplant medicine and outside. I work with the attendees, and I'm telling them how it works with any organ. They get the call from you, they have an organ. Your patient matches. Do you want to do it? And you go through all the details, the blood type, it matches the health of the recipient, the health of the organ, and everything else. And then they say, yes, we want the organ. That is when we send the team to recover the organ. The team goes to my hospital. They go here, take it, bring it back to my hospital, put it into the recipient. So that is for specific patients, whoever that patient may be, that organ is taken out for that patient. Maybe a backup. Maybe at my hospital, maybe at another hospital. But if it's not taken out specifically for that patient, it's taken out for the backup. But if you're on the list and you're going into the hospital, I call the patients, I bring them in, I work them up for the transplant. The organ is taken out for them specifically.
Interesting. Yeah. If that's the case, then we have problems.
If they're taking
it out because of you, then you are the donor. You might be the only match. Right? So that's the question. Is it a matchless or is it because of you? He's saying it's because of you.
There's a rabbi from Romania.
Not yet. Okay. How do they do it in Romania?
Just to understand one thing. If putting your name on the list is only this thing either, right? If putting your name on the list is only this thing either, isn't that lofeh by Pikuach Nefesh?
No.
Why not?
Because Lifnei Iver over here is, you are the cause of this person being killed. You are the cause of this person being killed according to our laws. What? You are Pikuach Nefesh. You can't kill somebody to save your life.
No, but you are not the one who's killed.
You are the cause of the person being killed. You're killing somebody to save your life. That's the problem. Okay.
Let's have a round of applause, really.